A shoot shall come out from the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. Isaiah 11:1.
Our salvation comes from something small, tender, and vulnerable, something hardly noticeable. God, who is the creator of the universe, comes to us in smallness, weakness, and hiddenness. I find this a hopeful message. Somehow, I keep expecting loud and impressive events to convince me and others of God's saving power. But over and over, we are reminded that spectacles, power plays, and big events are the ways of the world. Our temptation is to be distracted by them and made blind to the shoot that shall sprout from the stump. When I have no eyes for the small signs of God's presence, the smile of a baby, the carefree play of children, the words of encouragement and gestures of love offered by friends, we will always remain tempted to despair. The small child of Bethlehem, the unknown man of Nazareth, the rejected preacher, the naked man on the cross, he asks for all our full attention. The work of salvation takes place in the midst of a world that continues to shout, scream, and overwhelm us with its claims and promises. But the promise is hidden in the shoot that sprouts from the stump, a shoot that hardly notices anyone.
Shall we pray? Dear Jesus, we know that you can give us eyes to see the signs of your presence in the world, and we pray for this. But also pray for the faith in you for those times when we feel like we are not able to see, to understand, or feel your presence in our lives. Grant us the courage to persevere and to hope in that things that we cannot see. Amen.
Today's scripture reading is Psalm 122. Let us read now from the word of the Lord. I rejoiced with those who said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord. Our feet are standing in your gates, O Jerusalem." Jerusalem is built like a city that is closely compacted together. That is where the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, to praise the name of the Lord according to the statute given to Israel. There the thrones for judgment stand, the thrones of the house of David. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May those who love you be secure. May there be peace within your walls and security within your citadels. For the sake of my brothers and friends, I will say, peace be within you. For the sake of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your prosperity.
You weren't here last week, so we had to have somebody else take over your pumpkins. And this week we have two new people. Good to see you today. Are you going to help us decorate?
Yep. Yeah.
Did you decorate at home already?
No.
Not yet. Did you have Thanksgiving at home?
Yeah. No, not this year.
Not this year, but you celebrated Thanksgiving somewhere? And what are you guys... Kaylin, Asia, what are you guys grateful for, thankful for Thanksgiving? And the girls are going to write it on the pumpkins and add it to our pumpkins.
Our family and a nice dinner.
Okay. Get that one written in.
Both of us.
Family and a nice dinner. Think your sister can come up with something?
I don't know.
My camper.
Grandpa. Camper.
Camper?
Yeah.
What's a camper?
She has this little, like, it's a doll camper
thing. Oh, okay. Anything else? What other things are you thankful for? How about your brother? She shook her head yes. I didn't ask you if you were thankful for your sister yet, though. So we're thankful for our brothers. And now I have to ask you, are you thankful for your sister?
Yes.
Yeah. What other things are you thankful for?
Can you think of anything?
No.
She's going to let you do it, big brother. What other things are you thankful for? Can you think of anything else?
No.
Okay. So, we have to throw it to you guys. Since you've already celebrated Thanksgiving, what are you thankful for now? The girls are going to write for us. What were you thankful for after having celebrating Thanksgiving with your family?
Peace.
Church?
Peace and quiet.
Peace and quiet. That's a good one. Anything else?
Being here.
Being here. Absolutely.
The beginning of Advent.
Beginning of Advent. Sure. Thanksgiving always leads us into Advent. And we think that it's not going to be so soon. But every year we know it is. Right? Every year we say... It can't be Advent already, but it is. What other things are you grateful for? Go ahead, Joe.
Continued good health for both of us.
Continued good health. Very good. Anything else? Al. I'm
grateful for 34 years we've been together, and we're still together.
Okay. 34 years of marriage. Anything else? Well, we'll try to continue to put our blessings on our pumpkins, even though we're going to be beginning Advent, because as we start in December, the youth and our children are going to be working on their Advent tree, we'll call it this year. And so we're going to be sharing different things during worship, and the kids will have a task to do to lead them through till Christmas. So... remember that all things that God gives us are blessings, and sometimes we recognize them, and sometimes they're there and we don't recognize them. But we have to acknowledge that God gives us all good things, okay? Thanks for helping today, and we'll see you decorating, right? I didn't hear any grumbles. That was a new hymn. It's okay, wasn't it?
Yes.
Familiar tune.
Familiar melody, though.
Yeah. But it talked about hand in hand, and especially today, we hope that we do work hand in hand to do what needs to be done, and that God continues to bless us. Our scripture lesson this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 24, beginning with verse 36. Listen as Jesus continues to teach his people. No one knows about the day or the hour, or not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. For in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, up till the day Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. That is how it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. Two men will be in the field, one will be taken and the other left. Two women will be grinding with a handmill, one will be taken and the other left. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know on what day your Lord will come. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known at what time of night the thief was coming, he would have kept watch and would not have let his house be broken into. So you also must be ready, because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect him. May God bless us with the reading of these words this morning. Now, I chose this gospel lesson for two reasons. First, it talks about being ready. And secondly, it talks about waiting. As we begin Advent, these are two key words that we will live with until Christmas arrives. Be ready. You know what that means. Even though it may look differently for each of us or each of our families, there's a ton of things we do to get ready to celebrate the birth of Christ. And although many happen in our church, and you'll see that happening after worship today, there are many more things that happen in our homes, in our places of employment too. Last week I talked about balance, and this week we need to remember that as well. How can we balance all that needs to be done so that we can explain loudly, "I'm ready"? Well, perhaps I should ask if anybody's able to say that on December 24th. Will you be ready? I know that many will say, if anybody asks if they're ready or not, the response will be, "Well, Christmas is here, ready or not, we can't change it." I know that many people will say that they didn't have enough time, that Christmas came quicker than they expected. But we know it comes the same time every year. But we all use that excuse. It came so quickly. If we're not ready for Christmas this year, oh well, there's always next year, isn't there? We go through the same motions each year, following the old habits of shopping. Did anybody go out Good Friday? Yeah, Black Friday?
Nope.
Brave, if you did. The habits of wrapping, the habit of writing Christmas cards. I don't hear any moans yet. Putting up decorations, buying a tree, fighting with lights that are always tangled. There's so much more. If you have young ones in your family, the preparations include a million more things. Letters to Santa, school programs, photos with Santa, exchange gifts, teachers' gifts, and on we go. But you see, there's a big difference between being ready for Christmas and being ready for what our scripture is talking about this morning. I'm not sure if everyone would agree on which one is more difficult. Guess that's up to the individual. But being ready takes on another meaning when we talk about the second coming of Christ. Ready or not, the results are a bit different than being ready for Christmas. The consequences will be much more permanent than just disappointed youngsters or spouses. As scripture tells us, when that day comes, some will be left behind. And I can tell you, I don't want to be one of them. There is not a special season to help us prepare for that event. You see, we should be preparing every day of our lives. And yes, I know that I'm preaching to the choir because you're all here today, but there is more that each of us can do to deepen our faith in Christ Jesus, for none of us have reached perfection yet. So as we are getting ready for Christmas Day 2016, let's make sure that we are also teaching others about the reason for the season, that we are busy showing God's love to others. And yes, it is extremely difficult when everyone is rushing around trying to get the best bargains. But that's what we're called to do each and every day. Now, the second word I want to focus on today is waiting. I know this is something I have difficulty with almost daily. And while I deal with it okay most of the time, it doesn't mean I do it well. Now, with the Advent season in full swing, waiting is a part of every day. More traffic, especially around the malls. More people in the stores. More problems with credit cards. or with new employees trying to work those cash registers, or scanners that don't work. It's tough. But there's always more registers that we think should be open, right? And more grumpy, impatient people. And sometimes that person is the one we see in the mirror. For we get grumpy and impatient too. There will be more horn honking, more incidences of road rage. I think it's fair to say that we don't like to wait. Really, we don't like to wait for anything when you think about it. We live in a society that values immediate results, immediate satisfaction. The quicker, the better. The biggest example is the microwave oven, isn't it? It does in a few seconds what takes the regular oven minutes to do. We wait everything. We want everything to be plug-in ready, don't we? And we get frustrated when assembly is required. That's why some stores will come set up your new appliance. Sure, you'll pay for the convenience, but for most of it, it's something that we really need. In fact, one of my friends just gave away Christmas lawn ornaments that she bought last year, and she could never get them figured out how to put it together. She couldn't even get it back in the box. So she gave it away. There was no patience. Does that describe you during the holidays? Scripture tells us that we have to be ready and that we must wait. For many in biblical times, the Savior did not come quickly enough, so they abandoned their faith. Today, many pray, and when their prayers aren't answered the way they want them answered, they too abandon their faith. Scripture says that we have to be ready and we have to wait. We will not know the time. So this is the biggest test of our faith. We are to live our entire lives as disciples, as believers, and hopefully we will be ready when that time comes. I'm not going to tell you how to accomplish that being ready and waiting, for you know how to do it. I'm just going to remind you that you need to do it. I think that the more we prepare our hearts for Christmas, the better off we are. We need to put things into perspective using Scripture as our measuring stick. Perhaps read Scripture each time you're planning to face the crowds out shopping. Remind yourself of the true meaning of Christmas and know that you cannot change anyone else's behavior. You can only change yourself. So as we begin Advent, let us do more than prepare our homes for Christmas. Let us prepare our hearts once again so that we are ready to receive the gift of our Savior. We can prepare our hearts for the second coming of Christ by perfecting the craft of preparation and patience as we wait on that time. May each Christmas season bring that reality into each of our homes. And let us continually prepare to be the disciples that God wants us to be. Amen. Let us go from this place with those two words in our heads for this week. Prepare and wait. We're not good at either one of them. So with the grace of God, hopefully as we walk through this journey called Advent, we will continue to prepare our hearts and then be ready to wait for the grace that God has given us. Go from this place knowing that He loves you and cares for you, knowing that God equips us for everything that He wants us to do, and let us live with that grace. Amen.